The information contained in this program is for informational purposes only. Application to specific situations should be determined with a financial planning consultation. This program does not promote any particular products and makes no claims or implied guarantees with reference to market activities or investment returns. Securities are offered through WFG Investments Incorporated, member FINRA and SIPC. Mark Manila is a registered representative of WFG Investments Incorporated. Integrity Investors is not affiliated with WFG Investments Incorporated. When we begin to see that every decision we make not only impacts our lives today, but also has eternal significance, it becomes clear that personal finance is more than money. Welcome to More Than Money with your host, Mark Manila. Please join us as we explore personal finance from a biblical perspective.
Welcome, everyone. I'm glad you're here today as we do talk about finances from a biblical perspective. And one of the things regarding finance is small business. There's so many very small micro businesses. Entrepreneurs seem to be just all over the place these days. It seems like every week, at least once or twice a week, I'm running into somebody who's wanting to either start a business, buy into a franchise, do something to take control of their finances because they don't trust corporations or government anymore to make sure that things are done right. So they want to bring it into their own hands. And that's a great thing in many ways. You know, the only thing the Lord's going to hold us accountable for is what we do, not what somebody else did to us. We're not going to be held accountable for that. We're just going to be held accountable for how we react. So when times get rough, maybe it's a good time for for people to step up and say, you know, it's time to stop relying on corporations or other people to do business and start doing it ourselves. Unfortunately, a lot of people have never experienced what it's like to start, run, and succeed at business. And I say unfortunately because the big, giant monster that hovers over everybody, and that fear that keeps them from going into business, is going to be there until they confront that monster. I want to encourage you, if you're listening right now, to pray about it. Not everybody is made to run a business. Not everyone is made to start a business. Some people are great at administration. Some people are very poor. Some people are great at ideas, but implementing those ideas, not so much. You know, so there's all different types of people. But the one person, type of person that I found in my life that I've come across that has the hardest time starting a business are those people who just cannot handle stress. Because starting, running, and succeeding in business is one of the hardest things you can do because you work for everybody and you work for yourself. You work for your vendors, you work for your clients, you work for your customers, you work for your family. It's just, you take it home with you at night, it's in your dreams, it's all over the place. But when we think about getting into business, one of the things we don't have very often is a how-to book. Oh, there's starting a business for dummies and all sorts of books like that. But really, there's no true how-to. And I think that's really sad because, yeah, there are books that tell you how to do the accounting, how to possibly get a loan or to get backers or how to do this or do that. But I've never found a really great book on how to do exactly what it is you want to do, because that's what makes you unique, is that you have a great new idea and you think that people will want this idea and you're willing to dedicate your life to making it happen. But what can happen is there's different ways we learn. We learn by experience. We do it. You know, I've started quite a few businesses in my life and most of those are gone away. Some of them I succeeded at and sold. Some of them I actually failed at. You know, it just didn't work. And from all that, I've learned a lot. I've learned what my weaknesses are. I learned where my strength is. I know the type of people I need to hire to surround myself with to bridge that gap of my weaknesses. And I know the type of people that probably I wouldn't be good working with because we're stepping on each other too much. But here's the deal. There's another way to learn too, and it's by other people's experience. And there's a new book out called Entrepreneur Intervention, Triumphs and Failures of Entrepreneurs. And it's a book just filled with all sorts of lessons from entrepreneurs, small business owners, people who have started business. And joining me right now, the author of the book, the gentleman who brought all this together so you didn't have to go out and stumble and bruise yourself so much that you give up. You can read, you could learn from others, is David Domzalski. Welcome to the show, David.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it.
It's an interesting book. You know, one of the things that the hardest way to learn is by other people's experience. But you cover all different topics in here. You just didn't interview these entrepreneurs. And you like I heard somebody say, just it might have been you. It might have been you said earlier. You got some Joes and you got some pros in here. Mm-hmm. And that's really interesting because you've categorized these pros and these business owners into different areas to help people understand what it took to both fail and succeed in those areas. Tell us a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, let me kind of walk you through the process of how it all came together. You know, I started the whole process back in July 2011 of putting Entrepreneur Intervention together. And, you know, I didn't want to just write a book about my experiences because, you know, I'm a fairly young guy. And I don't think people would have really taken it seriously. They want somebody who's kind of, you know, been in the entrepreneurial realm for a long time here. So what I did was I used a resource called Help a Reporter Out. It's helpareporter.com.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And, you know, I really received a tremendous response. I mean, I must have gotten about 100 or so responses there. And, you know, we whittled it down to about 28, which is what you find in the book. And, you know, I really wanted to be a solid resource for entrepreneurs out there so they could really see how it's done. You know, I mean, and what's great about these people is that they're real everyday people. I mean, it's focused for Generation Y, but because that's what my company's focused on. But, you know, I think anyone through all walks of life, through any age, could really get something out of it. The point is that, you know, some of these people faced some of the most troublesome circumstances that we as human beings have to go through. You know, some of them lost loved ones. Some of them are in massive debt. Some of them were, you know, dealt with types of abuse, and, you know, they were unemployed, and just some terrible stuff. But the point is they pushed through it, and they overcame it, and that's really what the true essence is of being an entrepreneur is. And it just so happens that they did it through their personal lives as well.
Yeah, yeah, that's. I think you brought up one of the keys. Obviously, you have started and run some businesses. One of the keys is to just push on through it.
Right.
You know, this isn't the end when it seems like it's the end. It's just the beginning. There's been some. I've had those times too, where in certain businesses, it's like I should just roll up and move on and do something different. But if you just stay at it, if you believe in what you're doing and you stay at it, you'll grind it out somehow. And things that seem like they're, you know, it'll never take in a week from now look totally different.
Exactly. And you know, I'm not sure if you or your listeners have ever read Napoleon Hill's Think and Grow Rich.
Oh, sure.
But there's a little nugget in there that says it's a story about a guy who was 3 feet from gold, quote unquote.
Yeah.
He gave up when he was 3 feet away, and then someone else came along and kind of took it over from him. But it's that idea. When it's the hardest, that's when you're closest.
Yeah. They say the last lap.
Exactly.
The last lap is always the hardest, and that's the one most people give up on, is that
right.
Last lap. I can think of one in the software business that my buddy and I started, and my brother, actually. I remember we were just getting to the last lap of development to get the product out there, and it just seemed like everything hit the fan continuously for about a half a year. It just didn't seem like we could make it, and Steve, that was my partner's name, and I just sat down one night over dinner. And we just encouraged each other to just stay focused, keep pushing. You know, it's just, this is the last lap. This is the final 1%. This is where everybody else gives up. And as we push through, boom, then the doors open, the sales started. And, of course, it wasn't all gravy after that, but it wasn't that last lap anymore.
Well, and that's what I think is important, you know, having someone else maybe who it maybe is in your business with you, or, you know, some other entrepreneurs out there that you meet, whether, you know, online on Twitter or at some meetup or just some, you know, college buddy like I have. I have a couple college friends who we're all kind of starting businesses and doing our own thing, and we kind of talk to each other. We mastermind, I guess you could say, and mm-hmm. that's really helpful, just having someone who's going through it with you and just, you know, encouraging you and saying, you know, don't give up on that last lap, like my cross-country coach used to say back in high school.
Well, let's talk about the different areas that you have in here. You just didn't cover, you know, just in general, here's some entrepreneurs, but you broke it up a little bit into different areas. Let's talk about those different areas. Leading the way.
Yeah, well, you know, I started with JW Marriott because I kind of, first of all, I wanted people who maybe you didn't know much about. Like, you know, everyone knows about the Hilton because of the Hilton sisters, but you don't know about Marriott. So I wanted to kind of take you through what JW's story was. And the kind of the other one I got in there, Peter Kelly and Jeremiah Sullivan, they're from Framework Media Strategies. The reason I have those guys in there is because they graduated college in 2009 from Seton Hall University. And, you know, since the Financial Bin is focused on Generation Y, I really wanted to get those guys out there and put them front and center and say, here are a couple Gen Yers that are doing it. And, you know, they are kind of working their side jobs, but, you know, here they are. They're putting themselves out there. You know, they're only a couple years out of college, and here they are. They're really making some headway, and they're some guys to watch. And then another kid, the last one I have in that section, his name's Lane Sutton. And the reason I had to put Lane out there is because he's 14 years old, and he is kind of really made some headway in the social media realm. What's kind of cool about him is that he's spoken before, you know, Ivy League schools and major conferences and worked with people maybe four times his age to kind of give them an idea of what social media is all about, because for some people, it's, you know, especially ones that haven't grown up in the, you know, with the iPad attached to their hip or the iPad attached to their hand, you know, they need some help. They need an idea of how they can use Facebook and Twitter and Skype as a in the marketing realm, and that's what Lane really has touched on and really been quite successful at.
You know, and it's kind of interesting to think about 14 years old.
Yeah.
Entrepreneur. But I think maybe it's kind of like that creative thing. When we're little children, we're all creative. We're all just reinventing everything. We're learning everything and we're reinventing. Somewhere between that age of 5 and that age of 18, the school system seems to beat the creativity out of us. And I think the same thing's true with entrepreneurism. For most people, they're not encouraged, but they're taught to, you know, just stay the course. You know, you'll get a job, you'll work for somebody, you know, just pick the right courses. But here's a 14-year-old that says, you know what, I got an idea, and I'm going to pursue it.
And, you know, he's 14, so he can't drive, so, you know, his parents are encouraging him because they're carting him around.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Out of all the people that you've interviewed in this book, mm-hmm. was there anybody that just made you step back and go, whoa, I didn't expect that?
Well, you know, it had to be Kathy Anderson. Her chapter actually leads the way. It's called "Rise to Your Greatest Endeavors," and the reason I put Kathy first wasn't necessarily because solely of her entrepreneurial background. It was because I felt like if you're coming into this book and you're skeptical, I wanted Kathy's first because of how inspirational it was. And you know, we started off by talking about I told you about some of the abuse some of the people have suffered, and she was one of those that suffered some terrible stuff throughout her life, and I wanted it to be the overarching example and kind of give you put you in this certain mindset throughout the book, and that's what Kathy does, and her story is very inspirational, and she really just doesn't go into what she talks about. She goes into, you know, ways for you to kind of put yourself into that mindset and say, I can do this. You know, if Kathy says, you know, if I can go overcome this, you guys can do anything. And here's how I did it, and here's what you can do.
Oh, wow. And that is powerful, because recently, do you know who Johnny Erickson Tata is?
I do not.
Okay. She was a lady who, as a teenager, dove into a pool, broke her neck, and was paralyzed from the neck down.
Wow.
And, you know, strong believer, but she even asked God to kill her because she didn't want to live like that, you know? But then here it is. I see her last month. I was blessed with the opportunity to see her. She has done so much. Right now, she's helping children all over the world get wheelchairs, and she's learned to draw with pencils in her mouth and
wow.
artwork. She's just a dynamic entrepreneur who loves to help people. And you look at her, I remember going to that conference and meeting with her and getting to talk to her for a while. And the week before that, I whined and I complained about so much in my businesses. You know, it's like, well, the systems aren't working and this is wrong and I can't get this in place. And, you know, and then I go and see her and it's like, I have nothing to complain about. Life is good. And I am blessed, you know. She just encouraged me so much to see somebody with so much to overcome do so much. You know, I'll be I'll be happy if I achieve a quarter of what she's achieved in her life.
Absolutely. And I think people forget that, you know, entrepreneurship isn't just about the profit. I mean, you know, of course, that's important for you to continue with your business, but it's about solving a need. But it's even more than that with her. I mean, she has this, she cares more about other people than focusing on herself.
Mm.
That's the beauty of it. And that's what people forget when they think entrepreneurship. You know, it's not just about, you know, creating a thriving business. It's about the people you affect. And you know, there was a similar story to what you were talking about. I forget the girl's name, but I just remembered seeing it on TV at some point a couple weeks ago. And it was kind of the same idea. You know, this girl had this horrible disease. And instead of focusing on just her and crying, she wanted to figure out how she could use her situation to help others who may come down with the disease or already have it.
Mm.
She would try to find a way to create a foundation, and her parents were helping her out because she was a really young girl. But it's just that kind of stuff. I mean, that's entrepreneurial, and that's the beauty of it.
Wow, that's powerful. I also remember somewhere, and I can't remember, it might have been the introduction, but you had a statement that stood out to me. It said, honor your mind, I think is what it was. Or honor your thinking, something like that. But the whole idea was that, you know, and I'm just going to put my two cents the way I interpret it and the way I read it. It was that God gave you this brain. He's given you great ideas. Honor them. Write them down.
Exactly.
You know, and exactly. To me, that was a big point in the early in my life was when I started just keeping a little notepad, like, you know, you see in the old movies with the reporters, those little flip page pocket notepads. When I started keeping one of those around and started writing my ideas down, and every so often I'd review it and I'd start seeing similar or same ideas, and that guided me in a direction and said, you know, there must be a reason all these ideas keep coming regarding this or that. I think I'll pursue that, you know?
Yeah. No, I know exactly what you're saying, because that's really how it came together with the financial bin. You know, even as I've been with had the company I started for about a year and a half now, I've been into all of it, and you know, I still have ideas, and it's just amazing how it all just kind of coincides with exactly the mission I'm trying to go for. And I don't know. I mean, to me, you know, being a Christian, that just all of that is just culmination of what God's calling is for me.
Mm.
I mean, I don't question it. I know he's had me do all this for a reason.
Well, that's awesome. And that's the thing is that, you know, we see God does call us to personal responsibility.
Right.
First and foremost, that doesn't mean you can't work. It doesn't mean that you can't be a carpenter or you can't be, you know, work for IBM in mid-management. Those are all just as valid as starting a business.
Sure.
You know, your ministry is where you're called, wherever God puts you.
Right.
But there's so much that we just sit and wait as if somebody needs to do it for us in this society right now, instead of getting up and doing it yourself, whether it's looking for a job or starting a job.
Right.
You know, and that's what makes entrepreneurialism really exciting, is that there's so, if you really sit down and think about it, you probably could think of a dozen things any given day if you really sat down and think of services or products that people could use. And then the trick is, how do I provide that in a way that will bless them and provide blessings to me too? And, you know, that's the key. And it can be difficult. I mean, in here, you do talk about some stumbling blocks, and people talk about some hard times.
Sure.
You know, oftentimes books about entrepreneurship just paint this rosy picture, you know, just go for it, you know. But you have to see both sides of that coin and be ready for it and prepared.
Exactly. And you know, that's really why I, you know, when I started the Financial Bin, I had an idea, had an overarching focus, overarching what I wanted to accomplish with it, but it wasn't really until the past, you know, probably mid-2011, when I was really putting this book together, putting Entrepreneur Intervention together, that I really started to see, you know, it needs to be Generation Y, because that's where I'm at, and that's what I can really speak well to. And, you know, the whole thing, you know, whether it's Occupy Wall Street or whatever's going on, it's just, you know, you gotta rely on yourself. You gotta rely on God, and through that, He will help you figure it out yourself. But if you focus on making it all about someone else's problem, you're not going to get anywhere. You're just going to be blaming everybody else when really you need to be looking in the mirror.
Yeah, it means if it's everybody else that's the problem and you have no way to change everybody else, therefore it can't be changed, so I might as well give up.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah. And that's not what God has shown me. You know, yeah, you know, sometime we get ahead of God. We create these things we want to do instead of we need to do and that kind of stuff. But, you know, overall, I think God blesses somebody who gets up every morning and goes to work, whether it's going to work on their own plan, going to work to help people, you know, to serve, or just going to work to feed their family.
Exactly.
And, you know, and that's what's really cool about being an entrepreneur. And
well, and you know, with the financial bin, what my part of the motto is financial self-reliance. And to me, that means both in terms of obviously overarching faith, but we specifically in terms of entrepreneurship and personal finance. And, you know, to me, we start with the personal finance because if you can't handle your own finances, you certainly can't handle the finances of a business.
There you go.
And, you know, and the entrepreneurship kind of just takes it to the next level and says, you know, you're creating not really just a job, but you're solving a need for somebody else. And there comes a certain responsibility with that.
Mm. You know, there's this picture I was taught many, many, many years ago by one of my coaches, one of my business coaches that I went to, and he said, just do it. You know, the Nike thing, just do it type
Absolutely.
Of thing. He says, that should be the foundation of every entrepreneur. He says, because just imagine this tanker out in the middle of the ocean. You know, the decision to go right or left is useless if it isn't moving, because you can turn that oar any direction you want and it's just going to go wherever the wind and the wave blow it anyway. But if you're moving, if you're doing it, you can always correct course. You know, so right or wrong, whatever decision you make, it is better than just being still.
Absolutely. And, you know, if I wasn't afraid of copyright infringement, I would put that on the book, on the cover.
Yeah. There you go.
Just do it.
Well, listen, I really appreciate your book, and I'm hoping that this is on sale everywhere, right?
Oh, yeah. You can pick it up. Well, first of all, you can head over to financialbin.com and click on the book section up at the top, and it'll take you to all the outlets that it's on right there. Or just head over to Amazon, and it's available in paperback, and it's available for pretty much any e-reader you can think of, Kindle, iPad, and among others.
Oh, that's great. If this was the last radio interview you were going to do, if the Lord just told you you're done, I'm going to take you home tomorrow, don't think that way, but what would be the one thing you'd want people to hear about being an entrepreneur?
Well, you know, for the aspiring entrepreneurs out there, for me, I would say the person who will hold you back the most is yourself.
Mm.
It's not a venture capitalist that won't invest in you, or it's not your customers that aren't finding you or not using your product or service. As an entrepreneur, you have to make people care. And you do that by offering something of value that they need or want. And you need to overcome whatever fear you may have and just try it. Just do it like we've been saying. You know, that way you can make the mistakes, you can correct course, and then you can try again. And entrepreneurship really is more stamina than anything else. There are very few sprinters in this race that succeed.
Mm. Long-distance runners.
Exactly.
Staying the course. Yeah, that, and I think one of the tips that I would give is that know when it's time to hand the baton off to
True.
Somebody else, because I've held on businesses that really outgrew me, and I held them back, you know.
Right.
It was time to hire somebody who knew more about things than I did at that point. You know, the entrepreneur gets it started and running, but you need some experience at some point in time.
Exactly. You got to have the right exit strategy.
Absolutely. And the right focus, because
exactly
going into it, what is success?
Right.
If you don't know what success is, then you don't know when you got there. You know, you don't know when you've achieved it. And as a believer, of course, the definition of success is going to come a whole lot differently than for those who are non-believers, because in everything we do, we want to honor God. We want to honor Him by the way we treat our customers, the way we treat our vendors, the way we treat our partners, because we know that life is so much more than money.
For information about this show or to speak with Mark personally about your finances, call Mark Manila at 314-212-1404. That's 314-212-1404. The information contained in this program is for informational purposes only. Application to specific situations should be determined with a financial planning consultation. This program does not promote any particular products. It makes no claims or implied guarantees with reference to market activities or investment returns. Securities are offered through WFG Investments Incorporated, member FINRA, and SIPC. Mark Manila is a registered representative of WFG Investments Incorporated. Integrity Investors is not affiliated with WFG Investments Incorporated.
I just want to take a moment to thank you for listening. It's really an honor and a pleasure to serve you with this radio show. I pray it's a blessing to your life.